So good evening, everyone, and thank you for joining once again this Your Market Navigator series with us. My name is Bhavdeep Bhatt, and I co-head retail sales for Aditya Birla Sun Life Asset Management Company. Today we have a special guest, Mahesh Patil, who is the Chief Investment Officer for us for all our equity and hybrid funds. And today we'll be discussing all our funds in general, but more particularly frontline equity, equity fund, and focused equity fund, and also small cap fund. So these are the three funds that we'll be kind of deep dive in particular. And we have received lots of questions from all of you. Please keep posting your questions in Q&A section. Also important thing is, please remember that we will be answering all your questions regarding funds, but on stocks, on specifically stock price or stock recommendations, etc., we'll not be able to cover those questions. So please keep your questions around markets, around any specific fund that you have invested in or you are interested in. So welcome, Mahesh, to this Your Market Navigator series. And today, actually, we have received a few queries, questions rather, around also about the language. So we'll try to kind of mix up Hindi and English both.
Sure,
so that we can have all our participants find it useful. So, sabse pehle Mahesh, let me just ask you on the earnings and the GDP growth, because the first quarter, for the reasons that we all are aware, has been quite challenging. Our GDP numbers we last week print away or 23% degrowth in Q1. देख के काफी लोगों को ये सवाल है कि भाई ये साल के अंदर व्हाट इज द जीडीपी ग्रोथ दैट इज लाइकली टू काइंड ऑफ बी विजिबल एंड आल्सो अर्निंग्स ग्रोथ के पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू मतलब आपका क्या व्यू है कि ये फाइनेंशियल ईयर का अर्निंग्स ग्रोथ और अदर डी ग्रोथ कहां तक होने की संभावना है सो इफ यू कैन जस्ट ब्रॉडली कवर दैट पार्ट टू स्टार्ट विद फॉर ऑल ऑफ अस
या थैंक यू बाउदी एंड वेलकम एवरीवन टू दिस सीरीज And hope you all are safe and healthy. So yeah, so I think market economy pe to bahut zyada asar hua hai actually. First quarter was expected to be weak, but see in India we have actually seen India's growth in this quarter has contracted much more than the other economies. Probably because in India we had an extended period of lockdown, okay, than some of the other economies, and the stimulus, okay, which was provided by the government was much less than what we've seen, the stimulus which was provided by other countries like US, Europe, or China, or Japan for that matter, where it's been much bigger. Like the total fiscal stimulus which has been given is almost like 10-12% of GDP. And directly in India, the direct stimulus has been very, very small because, as you know, the government is facing challenges on the fiscal side. There are a lot of indirect liquidity measures taken, okay, to boost liquidity in the system, and liquidity is awash. But direct stimulus was very little. And as a result, we've seen this first quarter numbers contracted significantly. But I think one need not be too much worried about it, because I think things are now coming back after an extended period of lockdown. I think the government also has realized that this virus will be a way of life. And lockdown is not a solution, permanent solution. So things have been opening up in the metros and other places. We have seen various cities where lockdown has been lifted, and slowly the economy is coming back to normal. And we've seen that in some of the high frequency data which has been reported, whether it is energy consumption, okay, if you look at in this last month, has been almost coming back to the level what we saw pre-COVID levels. Auto numbers have also been coming back. The freight traffic has also, if you look at the tolls, okay, the transit volumes of trucks and this thing is only marginally lower than the pre-COVID levels as of last month. So things are slowly coming back. So this year, I think initially we were looking at a -4% GDP growth for FY21. I think it will probably be a tad lower at around, say, -5% or so in this fiscal year, which is still a very bad number. We haven't seen such a large reduction, a contraction in GDP, at least I don't remember, right, for a long, long time. So obviously, people would be wondering, GDP is the one of the worst what we've seen in many, many decades, and the market where it is, right? So what is the impact on earnings, and how is the market factoring in that? So on earnings front, if you look at while the GDP contraction is there, normally in a normal scenario, you would have seen that with a 6% contraction in GDP, your earnings decline in this year would have been huge. I mean, anywhere between around 20-25%, because there is an operating deleverage which comes into play. But if you look at a bottom-up analysis of Nifty companies, and after looking at the first quarter numbers, jo natije bhi aaye hain, to aisa lag raha hai ki this year the earnings decline would be around 10-11% is what we're looking at. And to some extent, it is looking a bit surprising. Khali, I mean, earnings growth is only declining by around 10%. So the reason for that is that even before coming into this COVID crisis in India, we have seen that India growth overall was still subdued. A lot of sectors were going through a pain, the banking sector, the financial services sector, pharma sector, the telecom sector. Many sectors had gone, infrastructure sector, and the earnings have been depressed if you look at the Nifty company, not for the last 1 year, but even for the last 4 years, right, compared to our nominal GDP growth. So there has been a repression in earnings now for quite some period of time with various factors. And even in this last financial year, fourth quarter, we had some impact of the COVID, right, in the last month, March month, mein lockdown chalu hua tha. Uske karan, fourth quarter numbers were also down. And that brought down the growth rate by FY20 numbers. So the base is slightly favorable. That is one factor. Secondly, what we're seeing is that in this quarter, many companies are, while the top line decline is there, companies have been able to manage the bottom line or EBITDA growth much better, because kafi jagah pe companies ne cost cut kar diye dramatically. Discretionary costs, jo hai, travel costs, waise bhi kam ho gaye, but all other expenses have been cut down sharply. And as a result of that, we've seen that the impact on the EBITDA line item, even while in some cases the earning top line was down 50% or 60%, but the EBITDA impact was not very large. And that is one big revelation that companies also realize, that a lot of costs, so normally in a normal year, you take a lot of costs for granted. But when crisis comes in, then you look into each and every cost item by a lens, and dekhte hain kahan pe apna cost kam kar sakte hain, kaun si cost zaruri hai. And I think they realize that there is areas where you can cut costs. And as a result of that, we see the earnings decline in this quarter was bad, but not to that extent. And I think some of these cost reduction, which is there, while some of them will normalize, okay, as things come back. But my guess is that many companies will find ways to permanently reduce costs. And when things normalize in FY22 or FY23, depending on which sector each company is, you would probably see the acceleration in earnings could be much faster than what people have anticipated. And many companies could actually report higher margin than what they had historically had. So that is something which I think market to some extent is starting to factoring in. And I would guess that this year, around 10-11% decline is what we are looking at. And next year, FY22, the earnings growth is at around 25%, obviously because of the low base. But kisko malum nahi, I mean, the numbers can be very, very volatile, because what we end with this year will be critical, and that will decide the growth for next year. But one thing is clear, that even globally, we are seeing a pretty V-shaped recovery in terms of economy. If you look at the economy in China, obviously it is back to pre-COVID levels or even above that. Even in US and Europe also, the PMI indicators which are there are almost touching the pre-COVID levels. To some extent, it could be also some pent-up demand. 2-3 months, everything was locked down, so there is some demand. Things might dip a bit, but clearly the recovery is very sharp. And thanks to the concerted effort by the central banks globally to ensure that there is enough liquidity, interest rates are low, and also the fiscal response by the governments globally to support the economy. So all these factors have taken everybody by surprise in terms of how quickly the economy has responded, and also market to that extent, right? So in India, I think the recovery will be slightly slower than what we see on the global front. Again, I'm reiterating that, because in our case, there are some challenges we have on the fiscal side. The government is not able to invest as much as it would like to because of the fiscal deficit. and they can't balloon the fiscal deficit beyond a point because of pressures from the global rating agencies, and you want to keep that within a particular rating profile. So, but I think we'll come back slowly and gradually. But I think one thing is clear, that after we come out of this crisis, the roadmap for India from a longer term growth rate is much better than the global growth rate. So while US and other economies will bounce back much faster and you'll see a sharp turnaround, their long-term growth will still remain muted, even for China for that matter. India has a potentially to grow at around anywhere between 5 to 6% in that range on a sustainable basis. And there are a lot of enablers also to that, okay, which we can discuss later. Like, for example, on the investment side, Make in India initiative, what government is talking about, getting some manufacturing out of China into India. And there's a lot of momentum which is building on in that. We can talk about that later, which sectors will benefit out of that. So that will mean that a long-term growth story for India still remains good. And while we have gone through this crisis, the macro factors for India are looking very good. When I say macro factors, means if you look at our broadly in terms of inflation, I think inflation has moved up a bit, but still it would like to remain in a fairly controllable range. On external front, we are very, very comfortable. In fact, even in this crisis, we've seen our forex reserves have actually gone up, right? On balance of payment, we are actually surplus. Even on the trade deficit, we are actually generating a surplus at this point in time. So that's the external front. We are very, very comfortable. In fact, rupee is actually appreciating. Okay, that's true across for all the currencies. But even in the overall debt to GDP also, we are at a pretty comfortable range. Our external debt is not very large. So all these factors, macro enablers, okay, which are there, will help us, okay, to come back out of it and also to ensure that we continue to grow and remain one of the large economy which is growing at a much faster pace. So I think that's the outlook, broader outlook on the economy and earnings, I would say.
Okay, interesting, Mahesh. So I think aapne kafi cheezon ke bare mein bataya, but ek jo mere liye kafi striking revelation tha wo ye tha ki jaise अभी डिग्रोथ हुआ है फर्स्ट क्वार्टर के अंदर, वो एक काफी एक दैट्स अ रियलिटी. यू सेड दैट रिकवरी इज गोइंग टू हैपन, दो इट माइट बी काइंड ऑफ बिट स्लोअर देन, और इट इज रादर बिट स्लोअर देन द ग्लोबल रिकवरी, बट रिकवरी इज रियल. एंड यू ऑल्सो सेड दैट 5 to 6% जीडीपी ग्रोथ यू नो इन इंडिया दैट विल इवेंचुअली हैपन फ्रॉम नेक्स्ट ईयर ऑनवर्ड्स और सो will still be a lot better than the global, most of the global.
I mean, next year, the growth could look much better because of the lower base. More from a, even beyond that, for say next 3 to 5 years, I think we can, should be able to easily achieve that growth rate.
So, aapka kehne ka matlab hai ki agle 3 saal FY21, FY22 aur FY23 ka hum log average growth gine, GDP ka growth. तो वो कितना हो सकता है? ये साल तो आपने बताया बार 5-6% का डिग्रोथ हो सकता है ये फाइनेंशियल ईयर में जीडीपी का. अगले 2 साल का हम लोग फाइनेंशियल ईयर्स का जीडीपी ग्रोथ ऐड कर लेंगे तो 3 साल का क्या जीडीपी ग्रोथ देखेगा हमको?
So I think for the next 3 years, looking at this year, will be almost -5%. So I think it might be slightly lower. It could probably be around 4.5-5% or so, because this year is a sharp decline. Next year will come back, but yes, but if you look at, forget about this year, but FY20, okay, if you look at it, FY20 last year was also slightly lower, but FY19 se agar dekhte hai, I think the normal trajectory for India's growth rate, I think should be around, at least around 5.5%, if you take a median on that. And that's the trend line we should take, because ye saal mein jo decline hua hai, uske basis pe agar aap value karoge companies ko, so you will be finding it very difficult. So I think we will normalize that by FY23, I would say. So FY19, say FY23 ka loge, okay, base loge, I think we should do a growth rate of around 5.5% or so. I think that's the potential growth that we should take. Aur wo basis pe hi humko analyze karna hai companies ko aur market ko dekhna hai, right? Because we have to project the earning, what is the underlying trend growth rate, assuming that this year was a kind of a bad year. And then value companies, and the market, okay, based on FY23, when things will probably normalize and we will be back to our long-term growth potential.
Interesting. Another interesting point that you mentioned was ki kafi areas ke andar recovery dekhne ko mili hai, whether aapne bataya auto sales ke andar matlab kafi companies ne almost pre-COVID level pe apna jo sales hai wo touch kar diya hai. Even digital payments dekho, for example fast tag dekho, ya ye sab factors dekhte hum log to lagta hai ki kafi had tak pre-COVID level pe economy ka jo momentum hai wo build up ho raha hai, another next few months we might reach there. बट काफी क्वेश्चंस में आज भी दिख रहा था महेश, ये है लोगों का कि भाई इकोनॉमी में इतना डीग्रोथ होने के बावजूद मार्केट इज ऑलमोस्ट इट्स वेरी नियर प्री कोविड लेवल. सो व्हाट रियली एक्सप्लेन्स, आई मीन व्हाट शुड पीपल रियली डू, बाय होल्ड सेल, व्हाट टू डू विद द इक्विटी इन्वेस्टमेंट्स राइट नाउ, क्वाइट कंफ्यूज्ड अबाउट बिकॉज ऑफ द डाइवर्जेंस बिटवीन इकोनॉमी एंड दिस.
So it is, I think it's taken everybody by surprise, even for us. I mean, while we were positive on the market, but the way the market has rallied and so quickly and so fast, despite the fact that the near-term numbers are still very, very bad. In India, mein toh abhi bhi COVID cases are going up. So what has really happened? Globally also, we've seen that. I mean, it's not India alone. It's a global phenomenon. Okay, what we've seen, US markets are at a new high. Nasdaq is much higher than even the pre-COVID levels. In Indian market is just about 7% lower from the pre-COVID high. So I think iska reason to, there are a couple of reasons for that. One is that the expectation of recovery, what people are looking at, is much faster and quicker. It's almost kind of a V-shaped recovery is what market is expecting in the economy, I'm saying. And that's one factor. Obviously, there is enough liquidity which is there globally. And the central banks globally have ensured that the interest rate is going to remain low for an extended period of time, right? I mean, US Fed has said that they will keep interest rate at zero for the next 2 years, right? Even if inflation goes up a bit, in fact, recently they said that. So that means that you will have very low interest rate. There is a financial repression, which is there. And you'll have enough liquidity, which is there. So that will help to recover the economy. But the market then becomes, a lot of money starts to move in and channelize quickly. Liquidity here. Mm-hmm. Or rates also very, very low. So money is coming much faster and quicker into the market, and market has started discounting FY22 numbers or FY23 numbers to a large extent today. And that's why we've seen the huge rally in the global market, because equities are always, the value of a company doesn't go down. See, I mean, bhale ye saal mein earnings are down by around 10-12% or whatever. But the value of a company doesn't go down by that much. The value of a company is not based on this year's earnings. Right? It's a summation of earnings for the next whatever, till infinity, till as long as the company is in existence. Right? So those earnings don't change. I mean, 1 year earnings can change. But market, historically, what used to happen is that whenever there is a downturn in a particular year, economic downturn or some kind of financial conditions, market is also correct sharply. But I think now, because of the way the policy response has been coming in from the central banks and the government much faster, market is able to come back much faster and look beyond this year and take a longer term view. And that's what has happened. I think it's come back largely to the pre-COVID levels. And that's where I think it is. Ideally, we would have liked to see valuations slightly more attractive to enter into the market. But the reality is that market is where it is at this point in time. So what do we do now, right? Your question is, abhi kya kare, right? So I think there are two ways to look at it. One is from a very short-term view, how do you look at this market? And from a longer-term view. So from a short-term perspective, I think the PE multiple, if you look at the market, it looks very, very expensive. And earnings growth, even for the next few quarters, is going to be fairly low. So there is no margin of safety, one would say, from a short-term perspective, and markets look fairly priced. And there could be some volatility, there could be some correction also in the market, okay, which is possible because of any risk factor, okay, which is there. And also to understand that the market is also to some extent fueled globally by a lot of retail money which has come into the market, right? One is institutional money, but a lot of retail money has come into the market because a lot of investors sitting at home and having some additional saving because there's nowhere to spend this money, right? So that money is getting channeled into the market. That money can be a bit volatile, right? If there is some kind of a, some kind of a shock, that can lead to volatility. We don't know when that will happen. Kabhi hoga wo maloom nahi hai. But that is the near term, I think we should be prepared for that. But I mean, equities is not about, you don't know, right? When that correction, and waiting for that correction, we've been waiting now for the last 1 month, or people for the last 2 months, wo nahi hua. So long term view kaise lagta hai? Chalo, theek hai, correction hoga, but agar main yahan se invest karta hoon, aur 3 saal ka view leta hai market mein, so how does it look? So if you look at that, then I think if you do a top-down view and look at coming back to the same question and the answer which I gave in the economy, aapko kaise dikh rahi hai FY22 or FY23 mein, actually more relevant, what is the normal rate of growth you will come to? If you do that, and assuming that things will normalize by that end, also the market valuations, okay, will also normalize. Okay, currently you can't look at price to earning multiple because earnings are depressed. Price to book value is a good indication, okay, to look at in this context. The price to book value multiple, if I look at from a long-term 10-year average, is slightly below the long-term average. Okay, it's still not above that. So markets are still fair, even at these levels. And over the next 3 years, you will see an increase in the book value, right? As earnings will grow. Forget about this year, but after that. And if you assume that kind of a growth rate of the next 2 years, FY23 numbers, and then normalize the multiples, then we see that there is still around 11-12% kind of a growth, okay, which the equity markets can deliver from here, which we think is a good growth considering the fact that interest rates, the real rates, are going to be very, very low. Even nominal rates are at around 5-6%. If you look at the G-Sec rates, 6% or so. So there is enough risk premium. Normally, you would require risk premium around 5-6%, which equities can deliver even from these level if you take a 3-year view. And that's why one should continue to invest into the market even at these levels. I think we should not hesitate because markets tend to also surprise on both sides, upside and on the downside. And I think it could happen that the momentum from here, at least the earnings momentum and this thing after the crisis, will continue to be fairly supportive. And normally what happens is that when your interest rates are lower, cost of capital is low, right? Your cost of equity also goes down. Because cost of equity, your discount rate you use karte ho companies ko value karne ke liye, is a function of your cost of debt, right? So, or the risk-free rate. So, you know, in an environment where we see low interest rates for a sustainable period of time, equity valuations, okay, can remain high and elevated compared to a long-term average, right? That is also one factor which we need to keep in mind. The long-term average P multiple was X. In an environment where average interest rates are going to be lower than the long-term rates, you can still justify a slightly higher P multiple. And that's what I think the market will kind of gravitate towards. Mm-hmm. And obviously, liquidity is going to remain abundant. Uske karan kya hoga ki pura liquidity ki wajah se the market PM goes up. And this abundant liquidity in India also, I think the central banks will continue to keep for an extended period of time. Isliye market aapko sasta nahi milega jada, right? What normally you would want to get. So you will have to look at where it is. Aur yahan se bhi meko returns kya mil sakte, which I think it can still give you reasonable, not a very high return. I think you can't expect because we are not buying something cheap at this point in time. Right? We are buying market which is like more or less fairly priced at this point in time, but we are then buying growth, right? Okay, over the next 3 years, time frame.
Interesting. So market bahut sasta nahi milega yahan se. That is a key message that you are giving.
Yes. And I mean, you're also short corrections milenge. We also expect correction, but corrections won't be very large. I mean, you can expect around 8-10% correction, I think, at least. I mean, nothing, we can't say anything about it. Okay, but that's what it looks like at this point in time, because there's also money which is waiting at the sidelines to come into the market, right? Mm-hmm. So I think any correction in this market, one should not hesitate and but to dip into that. If you're waiting on the sidelines, agar aapko invest karna hai, lump sum money hai, but you're waiting or market mein 7-8% correction aati hai, then one should actually dip into that and invest. That will only improve your long-term returns.
Interesting. So I think quite a few points you mentioned, and one of the things which was quite striking was the fact that equity mein sirf ek saal ka earnings jaane ki wajah se kafi log jo concerned hai हम सब लोगों के लिए एक रिमाइंडर है कि भाई इक्विटी परपेचुअल एसेट है, एक एक ऐसी ऐसा एसेट क्लास है जहां पे मतलब देयर इज नो डेफिनेट मैच्योरिटी डेट ऑफ दैट, राइट? सो यस, वन ईयर अर्निंग इज लॉस्ट, बट दैट डजंट मटेरियली इंपैक्ट द वैल्यू ऑफ द बिजनेस इटसेल्फ. सो
व्हाट हैपेंस इज जस्ट सिंस यू टॉक्ड अबाउट दैट, इन मेनी केसेस कंपनीज नो द अर्निंग्स और द रेवेन्यूज गेट्स डेफर्ड, राइट? कुछ का कुछ सेक्टर्स में इट गेट्स लॉस्ट परमानेंटली, राइट? फॉर एग्जांपल रेस्टोरेंट्स एंड ऑल दीस थिंग्स, अगर बाहर मेक आउट इज लॉस्ट, बट डिस्क्रिशनरी साइड में लाइक फॉर एग्जांपल ऑटो सेक्टर है और एनी अदर डिस्क्रिशनरी, यू विल डिफर दैट, राइट? अगर आज ये साल अगर आपने नहीं खरीदा, ओके, बिकॉज ऑफ वॉट एवर योर कॉन्फिडेंस इज लो और योर इनकम इज गॉट इम्पैक्टेड, यू विल डिफर दैट, एंड दैट डिमांड विल कम इन लेटर, राइट? एंड कैन कम क्यूमुलेटिव. सो इन मेनी केसेस एक्चुअली द अर्निंग्स और द रेवेन्यूज get deferred, okay, only is delayed probably by a year, it's not lost. That is something you need to keep in mind. But market is driven by sentiments, right? So market correct ki hota hai, because you look at very near term and you get gloomy or things are bad and there is a liquidity issue or people come on them, and that's why the market tend to react much more, and which is an opportunity for investors, right? Sensible investors, smart investors see this as an opportunity and enter the market. I mean, if somebody had put a money in the markets around 4 months back, and the market is up 50% from those levels, right?
Correct. But how many people actually got to participate at that level is just, as you rightly mentioned, it's a matter of sentiment. And at that point
in time, and people have been waiting also to participate in the market, right? Correct. Jo bhi miss hua, to wo bhi miss hua. Isliye best thing is to continue to invest as long as the market doesn't become overtly expensive. So we are nowhere in that very high euphoria hai, but not in a zone we can say it is overtly expensive. If you take a, I'm not taking a very long time, you need to take a 3-year view on the market.
Okay. So actually I wanted to move to products, but the since you have mentioned the point, let me just bring one question which Neha has asked. When should one exit from the invested mutual fund? How to track the performance of the fund and stay invested? So essentially the message that I get from this before, now immediately after this, we'll move to products because lots of questions are around products. But on this one, what would be that level or market condition, Mahesh, where you would really say that, you know, from this level, it looks really difficult that investors will make even FD kind of return or, you know, fixed income kind of returns. So what would be those 2, 3, 4 factors that people should keep in mind and watch out for?
Sure. So I think you should look at multiple. I mean, we run an asset allocation model and we continuously evaluate, right? What should be the allocation at this point in time? And we could have talked about it later. So we look at multiple parameters. First is to understand in what kind of economic cycle we are in, right? Cycle mein kahan pe hai? Bottom of the cycle hai, ki mid of the cycle hai, ki top of the cycle hai. Right? That's the first thing we look at it. Right? Currently, if you ask me, we're at the bottom of the economic cycle. So that's good news, right? Because things will improve from here. Secondly, is you look at the earnings, right? What is the kind of multiples earnings growth you're looking at over the next, not 1 year, but say over a 3-year time frame is what we would look at. Secondly, you would look at the asset valuation, the book value, which is like a price to book value, which is the asset valuation, right? Because asset valuations don't change much, right? They're not so volatile because the asset value is not dependent on 1 year's earning. So you look at the price to book value multiple and see where it is compared to historical levels. So that is another thing to look at. Okay. Now, so there are some factors which will be looking like earnings multiple, the market will be expensive. But if I look around the economic cycle, it is the bottom of the cycle, right? Mm-hmm. We are on the peak of the cycle. And asset valuations are at fair range and price to book value multiple is slightly below the long term. It's in fact slightly attractive. So the two out of the three indicators are looking good. So it's still fine, right? If all three are good, then you get very high returns, right? But with these factors in place, and if you project over the next 3-year time frame, as I mentioned earlier, and without assuming that there is a significant re-rating of multiples over a longer term, we think that market returns are still going to be around 11-12% from this level. Okay. So that is, I think, how we will look at. So when we are at the peak of the cycles, the valuations are also at its peak level, both your price to book, then that's the time where you should start taking out money from the market. So currently, our asset allocation model is suggesting us that for an asset allocation perspective, we should be having a higher allocation to equity than our average allocation, our target average allocation to equities. That's what it is suggesting.
Not
if you take a 3-year view. Obviously, if somebody has a 1-year view, देन अगर आपका एक साल का ही पैसा है देन द रिस्क टू रिवॉर्ड डजंट लुक दैट ग्रेट फॉर द मार्केट एट दिस पॉइंट इन टाइम इफ यू आस्क मी नो आई मीन इट इज ओके काइंड ऑफ रिटर्न एंड प्रोबब्ली यू विल गेट से हाई सिंगल डिजिट रिटर्न सो आई मीन वेरी डिफिकल्ट टू प्रेडिक्ट बट दैट्स व्हाट यू कुड लुक एट एंड देयर कुड बी सम डाउनसाइड आल्सो व्हिच कुड बी देयर देन अकॉर्डिंगली वी विल टेक कॉल बट most of the money for equity will be at least say 3 years or beyond and okay. that's, from that perspective I would say that this is not a time to take out money okay from the markets you should sure. continue to invest and your target equity allocation should be slightly higher than mm-hmm. your average allocation what you would want to keep at this point mm-hmm. in time
Got it. I think it was quite a comprehensive answer. Essentially, आप बता रहे हो कि growth is coming back. Lot of demand is kind of delayed, not denied. So that will make sure that companies will get that benefit. You also talked about interest rates being low and how does it increase the equity premium and therefore an impact on equity potential returns. You also talked about liquidity and the policymakers' response or the policy response to this COVID situation. Etc. So I think all these factors are really making a point that over the next 3 year period, markets still look reasonably attractive. You made a point that it's not like very cheap, but we can has a good potential to kind of outperform fixed income. So now अभी ये level पे महेश अभी हम लोग थोड़ा products के बारे में बात करते हैं. So हमारे काफी partners और investors को मालूम होगा. नहीं मालूम है तो हम लोग yesterday we completed 18 years of frontline equity fund. और ये जो 18 इयर्स की हिस्ट्री है फ्रंटलाइन इक्विटी फंड की उसमें जो एक सीएजीआर रिटर्न सिंस इंसेप्शन है वो हुआ है वो जो डिलीवर हुआ है वो 18.78% है सो दैट्स अ वेरी सब्सटेंशियल काइंड ऑफ एक्सपीरियंस दैट इन्वेस्टर्स हैव गॉट सब्सटेंशियल एक्सपीरियंस ऑफ वेल्थ क्रिएशन दैट ऑल आर इन्वेस्टर्स सिंस इंसेप्शन वुड हैव काइंड ऑफ एक्सपीरियंस काफी लोग आप जानते होंगे कि जब भी महेश ने ये फंड 2005 में राइट महेश 2005
यू सो आई स्टार्टेड माय सो आई हैव कंप्लीटेड मोर देन 15 इयर्स ऑफ
सो व्हेन महेश
2005 अक्टूबर 2005 एंड आई स्टार्टेड मैनेजिंग सो इन फैक्ट ऑन अ 15 ईयर बेसिस आई वाज जस्ट लुकिंग एट द रिटर्न्स इट्स गिवन 14.6% एंड इट विल स्टिल बी द नंबर वन फंड इन द लार्ज कैप कैटेगरी ओके इफ आई टेक अ 15 ईयर period there have been ups and downs over there we've seen that is typical just like markets funds also see despite last 2 years FY CY18 and CY19 being a slightly not a great year and we'll talk about that okay mm-hmm. in detail despite that the returns will still be the number one fund in the large cap category
wonderful so I didn't know myself didn't know Mahesh that one so many congratulations for that I think number one in 15 year and when you you took over this fund I remember that the fund size was 7 crore and as we speak today fund size is well over 18,000 crores for all our partners and investors on the call so Mahesh why don't you just take us through the journey of frontline equity very very consistent sound alpha generation from 2005 all the way till end of 2017 Then we had a couple of challenging years in the form in the year 2018 and 2019, and again the fund is back in 2020. So can you just walk us through how do you really manage the fund and what caused the last 2 years volatility? Because lots of questions were there around frontline equity because it's a core to many investors' portfolio.
Yeah.
In the large cap space.
Yeah. So I think let me just take you through in terms of the philosophy of this fund because it's very important to understand the fund philosophy and that's varying in terms of how the fund will do in a different in a particular market cycle. So frontline equity historically we have maintained a kind of a very diversified portfolio. The idea was to ensure okay that we take measured risk in the fund and build a diversified portfolio to generate alpha. Not taking very large concentrated bets in a particular stock or in a particular sector. I mean, that's been the style. It's worked pretty well. There have been few instances earlier also, right? For example, I remember in 2010 to 2012, 13, when there was a sharp rally in the market. Okay, after the financial crisis, it moved up. Again, it underperformed that point in time. But by and large, in the last 14 years, 15 years, out of that, except for the last 2 years, right, the fund had beaten the benchmark in every calendar year. That was the track record which was there. So what went wrong in CY18 and CY19? Okay, couple of things. 1A is that in that period we saw after 18 kya hua ki market mein there was a big divergence which was there right between the Nifty and the mid cap and small cap index, right? And also within Nifty, okay, if you do take out the top 5-6 stocks and the broader Nifty, there was a big divergence. And in front end equity, we also had some amount of mid caps, say around 15% in mid cap. That was always the nature. Aur pehle iska benchmark BSE 200 tha. We maintained that even after the benchmark became Nifty or became a large cap because it still met the requirement. And our philosophy was that if you have a measured mid cap exposure over a longer term, you will generate decent alpha to beat the benchmark. And that's how the fund historically had given almost 5% alpha until CY 18 vis-a-vis the benchmark. But what has happened is because of the way the market has been and the money flow which has come into the market, the emergence of ETFs and this has happened is that the money channelized into a few stocks and that continued to move off. And that hurt us, okay, because we were underweight in some of the large index weight stocks. A few stocks like, for example, Reliance which we had in our portfolio and TCS for that matter. Our philosophy also as a house and specifically for this fund has been that growth at a reasonable price, right? So we always identified stock early and we wrote that. And when the valuation hit our target price, we booked profits or trim exposure and looked at other ideas, okay, which potentially look good. But the market was very peculiar in the last, in CY 18 and 19, where some of the top performing stocks continued to outperform irrespective of the valuations. And valuations multiple in some of these names continue to go beyond our expectations. So Reliance, for example, we used to have in our portfolio, we rode pretty well early, right? But somewhere end of CY 18, we went underweight Reliance significantly. And Reliance continued to outperform even from there. So that hurt us being large underweight in that stock. And even TCS also had a very good run. Our bet has been on, because TCS we thought was expensive and that continued to do well. So that was one thing which hurt us. Secondly, was the breadth of the market. We used to always have a larger number of stocks here, like almost like 65, 70 odd stocks. And the belief was that you diversify risk, okay, by not, and since the fund size also became large, we didn't want to have a concentration, especially in the mid-cap names. And that breadth and the larger number of stocks hurt us because it didn't hurt us in the earlier period because the breadth of the market was good. But when the breadth of the market narrowed down, due to upper diversification, that didn't really add alpha. So that was another reason which led to the underperformance. Third was a particular sector, for example, which as a fund house, we were overweight financials, especially the NBFCs, which we identified very early in 2012-13. I remember Bajaj Finance was a stock which I first bought in 2013, right? And the stock went up almost 10 times, not even 10, 15 times from that level. It was a huge multi-bagger for us. But other NBFCs also caught on. And I think after the NBFC crisis, we had a slightly higher exposure in some of the NBFCs, especially the mortgage finance NBFCs. And we saw a significant derating of multiples over there. So that led to some underperformance. So I think these were some of the, I would say, the reasons, okay, for the why the fund underperformed. And we were, and being a fund last year, we thought, okay, market will normalize. So we took some time, we stuck to some of our bets, but market continued to behave the way it was. And so later on, I think we took somewhere in mid of CY19, we started to relook into it because it was high time, almost 1.5 years, okay, when we were still slightly dragging below the benchmark. And we looked into some of our holdings in the fund, the strategy, what we were running. And we took a couple of calls that, for example, in the large index weight stock like Reliance, okay, we decided, okay, there's no point trying to be too underweight. We will review it. And we'll keep, if you don't like, we'll keep our underweight, but within the manageable limits. Okay, so whenever Reliance corrected, we corrected the underweight and we did that. So that helped. Secondly, was while TCS was a large underweight, which was there, but our belief was Infosys will come back. But Infosys had 1 year of setback, right, because of the issues when there was a change in the management. But then subsequently, we've seen that Infosys has actually done well in the last 1 year because of better valuation and superior growth. So that has also, we've seen a comeback over there. We also consolidated our funds. The number of stocks which we had was much larger, especially the concentration in our top holdings, like top 10 stocks or top 20 stocks. Earlier, our top 10 holdings used to be around close to 38 or so. That has gone up to now 50%, right? So we have done, and even our tail, we have reduced it down. So that consolidation, while we still want to maintain a diversified portfolio, but we right-size it and say, okay, what is the maximum diversification which we want to do in this current market environment, right? Even going forward. So we really looked into that and consolidated the portfolio. So that has worked out well for us in the last 9 months, both in the market ups and downs. And finally, what we looked at a philosophy of growth at a reasonable price, right? So a lot of good quality stocks which we had in our portfolio continue to like. When they became expensive, we said, okay, fine, let's not look at only valuations and the near-term growth. Let's look at the long-term narrative for this stock, what it is. Right? And not only for this fund, but as a fund house, we've defined the narrative. That helps to look at a stock beyond the next 2-3 years numbers, right? When I say narrative, means what is the story for this stock? Like, for example, what is going to be the long-term opportunity in the sector? How the company will grow? What is the competitive advantage? How it will continue to gain market share? And that is something which helped us to buy some of these quality stocks which we had missed earlier or we had sold off earlier, again, when the market corrected. The market corrected after the COVID crisis. We bought some of these, like Hindustan Lever, for example, we added to our portfolio. Then a couple of other stocks also in the segment, we had like Eicher Motors, which were expensive earlier. But when it came down, it corrected almost like 50%. We bought Eicher Motors at 1400 level. The stock, we didn't realize it went up by almost 50% in a matter of 2 months. But we did that correction. And now we have built a very solid and robust portfolio of good quality stocks, growth companies. Okay, they are slightly, some of them could be slightly expensive, but they could be good long-term compound within our portfolio. And I think we also took some good calls top-down, like in the pharma sector, for example, right? Our call to be overweight pharma last year, and we launched our pharma fund also, as you know, as a house, we did that. So those calls have also come in handy, especially in this period. As you know, pharma sector has been the best performing sector in the last 1 year. That has also worked out well for us. So currently, we are positive on the overweight on the pharma sector. We are overweight on telecom. Telecom also, we added Bharti at the right time. And that's done well. And we think we'll continue to do well from here. We want to build a good stock portfolio of stocks which are long-term compounders in a portfolio. Obviously, we need to get stocks at the right entry point, and we got an opportunity to buy some of these stocks. In our stock, some of these stocks we have been holding for very long, like Bajaj Finance. Unfortunately, we sold that stock or trimmed our weightage 2 years back because the valuation went up. But again, in this correction, we have added it back. We have a stock like in consumer space, we have a very good portfolio, and these stocks have done very well for us over many years. Stocks like Britannia bought it very early, okay. I remember around 5-6 years back, okay, when the company was going through a transition, there was a management change, margins were low, and that stock, I remember we bought it around, average price still is around 500. We have never added beyond that 450 average price. The stock is now close to 4,000. So there have been some of these good quality long-term winners in our portfolio, okay, which we continue to hold, and we have added a few in this crisis. So I think with these changes, okay, what we have done, and I think and also the cycle what we were seeing in the market in the last 2 years, what I'm seeing is now the market breadth is also improving, right? In the last 6 months, we've seen that the last 3 months the breadth has improved, and we think that trend will continue because the underperformance of the broader market over the last 2.5 years has been gone to one extreme, and as that happens, okay, we will see that this fund, okay, by the nature of design and listing, will continue to do well. And we're seeing that benefit of that. And also the good thing is that we've also started beating the benchmark now. And our objective would be that every year, like in the same track record of what we had earlier, I think we would want to beat the benchmark. And to that extent, I think earlier, the kind of deviations we used to take in this fund vis-a-vis the benchmark. And the new reality is that outperforming the benchmark now will be much difficult. There's no doubt about that, because way the markets will be. And also the percentage outperformance will be lower. Like historically, the fund had given a, say, before this crisis, around 4-5% outperformance. I think going forward, we'll be happy to target, say, around 150-200 basis outperformance. And that's a good outperformance to get for a large cap fund. right, mm-hmm. to justify that people come to an actively managed fund. And accordingly, we will take risks in this fund. Mm-hmm. Also, deviations, what we take using the benchmark will also be accordingly calibrated. And I'm pretty sure that we will come back. We have seen multiple periods in this fund, ups and downs. And I think last 2 year period, I think we've been working hard to see that we come back and also ensure that whatever mistakes we have done, we've re-looked into it and done the course correction wherever it need to be. And I think the next couple of years, I think we will not only overcome the underperformance what we had in the last 2 years, but also do better than that is what our endeavor would be in this fund. So I think investors in this fund, I think, should look that this fund will be a steady performer in the benchmark. We would target a reasonable outperformance, not a huge outperformance, because that if you do that, then we're taking unnecessary risk. And we've seen that it will be difficult to generate large outperformance in this kind of a strategy. But I think steady outperformance is what our endeavor will be. And I think that's where we are driving toward. And the portfolio also has been, whatever changes we need to portfolio, we have done that, is well constituted at this point in time. And I think the recent performance is there for everyone to look at.
To draw comfort from, yeah, perfect. So I think it's very reassuring, Mahesh, and thank you for that journey of 18 years in terms of philosophy, performance, when this fund does well. And for all our viewers, I'm sure you would have captured this part. But ek baar fir se reiterate kar deta hu ki what Mahesh said is ki jab bhi market broad based hota hai tabhi fund ki jo philosophy hai, fund ka jo portfolio construction process hai, wo kafi acha sa perform karta hai aur outperformance mein एक 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 टेलविंड देता है. तो आपने 2005 टू 2017 कैलेंडर ईयर आपने देखा कि मार्केट मोर ऑफन देन नॉट वाज ब्रॉड बेस्ड एंड फंड डिड वंडरफुली वेल. वी डिलीवर्ड क्लोज टू 4.5% ईयर ऑन ईयर अल्फा इन दैट फंड ड्यूरिंग फ्रॉम 2005 टू 2017. 18-19 एक पिक्यूलियर मार्केट का जो एक एनवायरमेंट था वो प्ले आउट हुआ, वो पर्टिकुलरली जो डाइवर्जेंस के बारे में बात किया. तो उसके चलते जो फंड का जो फिलोसॉफी है विच इज डाइवर्सिफिकेशन दैट डिडंट वर्क आउट. फंड का फिलोसॉफी है कि एक पर्टिकुलर वैल्यू के ऊपर हम लोग कंपनीज में इन्वेस्ट करते हैं. सो रिलायंस एंड टीसीएस काइंड ऑफ कंपनीज वी डिड नॉट यू नो टेक ओवरवेट. इनफैक्ट वी वर सिग्निफिकेंट अंडरवेट एंड दैट कॉज बिट ऑफ अंडर परफॉर्मेंस. बट व्हाट मैच रियली एक्सप्लेन्ड वाज कि पिछले कुछ महीनों के अंदर कपल ऑफ क्वार्टर्स के अंदर फिर से मार्केट ब्रॉड बेस होना शुरू हो गया है. और हमको हमारा एक्सपेक्टेशन है कि मार्केट यही फॉर्म के अंदर आगे जाके ग्रो करेगा. और ये एनवायरनमेंट के अंदर हम लोग ने देखा है इन लॉन्ग टर्म की फ्रंटलाइन इक्विटी ने बहुत अच्छा परफॉर्म किया. और हमारा एंडेवर ये रहेगा कि हमको 1.5-2% अल्फा जनरेट कर पाए ओवर एंड अबव द बेंचमार्क. सो दैट्स आर एंडेवर देयर. सो मींस दैट लेट्स मी टू अनदर क्वेश्चन ऑफ
And just waiting for that for the fund to come back. We are taking corrective actions also. So large index stocks, okay, where we are underweight. Okay, we mm-hmm. have corrected that and we are monitoring it much more closely so that at least objective to beating the benchmark is first objective, okay, which we want to achieve.
But broadly, we do expect that markets, there is a higher probability of market broad basing from
yes,
here, right?
Yes, yes. That will only help further, no, I'm saying, yeah.
Perfect, got it. Another question, Mahesh, is the distinction between frontline equity and focused equity, both the funds that you are managing. So one fund, I mean, it's understandable that focused equity is a more of a consolidated portfolio compared to frontline equity. But what is the distinction between these two funds? Which fund is suitable for which type of investor? So if you can just create some distinction between these two funds, it would be wonderful.
Yeah, so see again, as a focused equity fund is also a large cap focused equity fund. So, वहाँ पे भी 80% would be in the large cap, which is the top 100 companies. So, the product set is similar. Now, so differentiate between these two funds, right? So, focused equity fund, a concentration obviously is there, 30 stocks. But we are trying to position it a bit differently because क्या होता है कि जब भी आप concentration बढ़ाते हो stock में, तो risk बढ़ती है, right? Because those stocks have to do well, right? If some of these, if few stocks don't perform for whatever reason, okay, there could be a challenge over there. So you have to be very careful in terms of the stock selection over there. So we decided, okay, let's position this fund at a slightly quality bias. What do you mean by quality bias? Quality bias is sub stocks, right? We always want to buy good quality stocks. But here we are slightly more stringent. here we said that, okay, fine. ये फंड में वी विल इन्वेस्ट इन कंपनीज व्हिच हैव लेस वोलेटिलिटी इन अर्निंग्स, ओके, जिनकी आरओईज आर स्लाइटली हायर, ओके, ओवर अ मार्केट्स, ओवर अ बिजनेस साइकिल, और आरओई की जो वोलेटिलिटी है वो भी कम है, जहाँ पे कंपनीज में लेवरेज इज नॉट वेरी हाई, ओके, एंड वेयर द कैश फ्लो जनरेशन इज गुड, फ्री कैश फ्लो जनरेशन इज गुड, एंड मैनेजमेंट क्वालिटी इज अबव पर्टिकुलर थ्रेशोल्ड, ओके, वी ऑल्सो हैव मैनेजमेंट क्वालिटी फॉर अदर फंड ऑल्सो, बट यहाँ पे थोड़ा सा we are having a higher bar, okay, what we are looking at, and that's where the bulk of the portfolio will be, right? So like, for example, our investable universe, okay, we look at say around top 130 stocks market cap wise, right? Usme se we want to filter out stocks based on these filters, and normally we'll come to around 70 odd stocks, right, which would pass this filter. और वो 70 स्टॉक्स में से हमको 30 स्टॉक का पोर्टफोलियो बिल्ड करना है, दैट्स व्हाट वी डू, एंड सो दैट्स व्हाट हाउ द प्रोसेस स्टार्ट्स इन टर्म्स ऑफ बिल्डिंग द पोर्टफोलियो फॉर द फोकस्ड इक्विटी फंड, एंड इन दिस वी टेंड टू आल्सो हैव द एनालिस्ट टीम जो हमने की है, उनके जो टॉप आइडियाज है लार्ज कैप में, लाइक दे आल्सो रन अ मॉडल पोर्टफोलियो एंड दे आल्सो स्टिक आउट अ लेग एंड से कि दीस आर द हाई कन्विक्शन आइडियाज व्हिच आर देयर, वी ट्राई टू try to large extent follow that, right, in this fund, which are our analyst high conviction ideas in the large cap space. That's the philosophy with which we manage the focus equity fund. Now, obviously, agar stock koi large cap stock focus equity fund mein hai, achha stock hai, obviously it will also be there in front-end equity fund. But in front-end equity fund, it will be much more diversified approach, okay, which we're looking at. And that's the nature we want to maintain that. Obviously, in front-end equity, we don't have any constraint. We'll also look at some of the cyclical stocks in front-end equity fund, because we want to, there in front-end equity fund, we want to actually have a much more tighter range in terms of, so that we take only marginal deviations vis-a-vis the benchmark and do that. Whereas in this case, by nature and by design, by concentration, you're taking a large deviation. But we are trying to minimize the risk by doing a filtration of stocks, okay, what we are investing into. So that's the primary difference which is there. So I think what you will see is that
suitability point of view, if you can just highlight what kind of, I mean, is there any investor segment which one product will be more suitable for compared to others?
I'm coming to that. So kya hoga ki for frontline equity fund, I mean, our expectation is that it will be much more steady in terms of vis-a-vis the benchmark, no? In terms of what kind of outperformance what it can do, or even underperformance. And in certain market environments, like when the market is much more narrower market, a focus strategy will do much better. Like we saw in the last 2 years, some of the focus funds have done very well, right? Provided you are in the right stocks. And assuming a stock selection is good, focus strategy would be better returns. In an environment where the market breadth is becoming larger and there are a lot of other companies which are participating, the ability and the flexibility what you have in a front, like frontline equity fund to invest. You might not take a large position, but you might like some stock, okay, which is a good stock. But you might not build a large exposure over here. And you want to take, say, just about, say, 1% exposure in the fund. You can do that. In focused equity fund, you can't do that, because you have to first exit a stock and you have to build a sizable exposure in that stock, right? So you can do that much flexibility, which will be there in a diversified fund, like a frontline equity fund, which can work out well and probably help you, we can get a better return over there. So whenever the breadth of the market is wider, there are a lot of stocks which are participating, much more opportunity in the market to invest into. When there is a wider mid and small cap, mid caps doing well, a strategy like frontline equity can do well. Focus will also do well, provided a stock selection is good, but then you have to be into the right stocks. So I would say that the returns in both the funds could be similar. Okay, possibly focus could be slightly better if you manage it properly. Okay, if your stock selection is good, you don't do too many mistakes, then the returns in focus fund should be good than frontline. But obviously the risk is higher, right? So the volatility of focus fund vis-a-vis the benchmark, not absolute volatility, but vis-a-vis the benchmark, will be much larger. So there could be a period where a 6 months period, 1 year period, the benchmarks ke samne the returns could be slightly more divergent than what we see, and which is also right for the higher volatility with the benchmark, the returns also should be slightly better there in the focused equity fund. But a lot of stocks you will see common. It's only the concentration, okay, which will be the key difference. Some stocks we might buy in focused equity fund, okay, some of the mid-cap names like what we have bought recently, like for example, Metropolis We bought in the Focus Equity Fund. We bought PI Industries. We don't have it in Frontline Equity Fund because, again, the size and this thing and the concentration, what we could get, we couldn't, because these are mid-cap stocks. But for large-cap stocks, I think you will find representation being same across Focus Equity Fund and Frontline Equity Fund. Only in mid-cap stocks, few stocks, okay, where there could be a slight differentiation between these two funds.
What are the limits for us in mid-caps? So, I mean, generally...
Mid-cap limit is around 15%, right, in both the funds. So, currently, in Frontline Equity Fund, our mid-cap exposure is around 10%. In Focus Equity Fund also, it will be around 8 to 9% in that range. So, if you look at the returns in Focus Equity Fund, incidentally, in the last 1 year or last 2 years, would be better than Frontline Equity Fund. Because the way the market was, right, the market was very narrow. Few stocks were doing well. The focus strategy, that's why, has given a better return. I mean, it's the same fund which I'm managing, same kind of stocks. The concentration is a bit different, and that has made all the difference. Recently, I'm seeing that in the last 3 months, the Frontline Equity Fund is doing better than Focus Equity Fund, right? But these will be there. For a longer term, I think more or less the returns should converge, is what one should expect.
Fair enough. So let's move now to small cap funds. So we have made a few changes in fund management team over the last few months. And particularly if you can just run us through the small cap strategy, because in that now we are running it as an analyst driven fund. So what are the mechanics of an analyst driven fund? What is the rationale behind it? And how does it really work? Because many of our partners and investors here on the call might not be familiar with it. So can you just walk us through small cap fund?
So I think, see, in the small cap space, as you know, the fund has not done that great. I mean, let's be frank about it. Okay, we've not, last 2 years performance, last 2.5 years performance has not been up to the mark. We took certain actions over there. We have made some fund management changes in mid-cap fund and small and mid-cap fund. So mid-cap fund has been managed by Anil, who manages our multi-cap strategy. So small and mid-cap fund, we thought that this is a fund where a lot of idea generation has to happen, right? And you have to continue. So it's better, we thought, analysts, okay, who are responsible for the sectors, okay, why not they manage this fund and they can look at some of these ideas in the small cap space, which also requires a huge amount of due diligence, okay, when you're buying a stock in the small cap universe. And if you have 8 analysts, okay, who are doing their, within their domain, they're working in their sector and trying to identify and doing the filtration, it could probably be a good idea. And we had done this kind of a analyst-driven fund. We were the first one in this industry to do that. If you remember, it was how much? Around 9 years back? Yeah, 8 to 9 years back, right? When we converted one of our closed-ended funds into a analyst-driven fund. That was a multi-cap fund, right? So analyst-managed multi-cap fund. Again, this is an idea which I had got when I had visited MFS in the US. Okay, as you know, MFS is one of our oldest mutual fund, and it's owned by Sun Life globally. So they have these analyst driven fund, and we thought it was a good idea to implement over here. It achieved many varied purposes in terms of giving a lot of boosting the morale of the analysts, because they can actually now buy stocks, recommend stocks, and buy into the funds. It's also a good way of showcasing your analyst capabilities, and also a good way to reward analysts if they do well in that fund. And that fund experience was very good for us. For the almost 5 years it was managed by the analysts, it was one of the top quartile funds within the multi-cap category. Despite the fact that in that fund, we didn't have much of a, it was pure a bottom-up approach. We didn't do large sector calls over there, right? And, but unfortunately, we had to merge that fund vis-a-vis, because SEBI didn't allow to have multiple funds in the same category, in the multi-cap category. And then there was a void over there. And when this opportunity came in, and the analysts also were very responsive, they said, okay, they are willing to take the challenge and manage this fund. And then we converted this fund into analyst-driven fund. And very important for this fund to be successful is to have a good process around that, right? Because when 8 to 10 analysts are managing this fund, we need to have a very robust process. And how do you decide on how much to allocate to a particular analyst, right? And then also top-down, it's a bottom-up approach, right, over here. And so we first decided, okay, there'll be one senior fund manager who'll be a mentor to this analyst. So we have one senior fund manager, Atul Penkar, okay, who is a mentor, okay, who broadly guides the analysts in terms of where the allocation should be. But and just to filter some of the stocks which the analysts are taking to the portfolio. But the finally it's the analyst call really to buy, and they are accountable and responsible for the stocks. And then the performance also is equally measured. So we have a mechanism where we calculate the attribution at the analyst level, how much alpha each analyst is contributing to this fund, and there is a certain target which is given to the analyst. And each analyst is allocated a certain portion of the fund to manage depending on the relevance of the sector, okay, what they are managing in the benchmark. And that's how we are doing it. So we have, since the fund was taken over around 3 months back, it's been more than 3 months now, we've been managing it. The current portfolio which was there has undergone quite a bit of a change based on the analyst's conviction, their recommendations, and we've done that process gradually. Now, more or less 90% of the fund has been in line with what the analysts want to be in, right? And the recommendations which has been done. And I think, let's see, I think the good thing is that there is a diversification which is automatically, right? It's not single, so there's a diversification across analysts. So hopefully, even if a particular analyst doesn't do well in a particular time frame, okay, others will be able to contribute and make up for that. So that would ensure that there is much more stability in this fund in terms of its performance, okay, which will be there. And I think over a period of time, we expect that this fund could be a benchmark, okay, for the industry in terms of trying to showcase the analyst capabilities, especially into the small cap segment. And there are various filters, okay, which we pass through. Before an analyst buys the stock in the portfolio, okay, it passes a lot of filters. And again, that's where the senior fund manager, who is a mentor, and myself, we will evaluate that company. The analyst has to make a presentation internally. And once it passes that filter, only he can buy that stock into the fund. So some of these checks and balances and risk management framework we have put in place, a very strong, robust process. And it's working well. And it's also a good motivator for the analyst, okay, to showcase their conviction in stocks. And we also have a good reward mechanism going forward, okay, performance-led reward mechanism, okay, which will help to motivate the analyst to really contribute their best towards this fund.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so we are coming towards the close. In fact, we are just overshot time. So just last question, Mahesh. So, किसी को investor के पास 100 रुपया है और equity में invest करना है. तो आपका क्या सजेशन रहेगा इन टर्म्स ऑफ इक्विटी एलोकेशन अक्रॉस आर से 4-5 फंड्स इफ दे वर टू पिक अप फ्रॉम बिरला म्यूचुअल फंड व्हिच फंड शुड बी देयर एंड व्हाट शुड बी द एलोकेशन आल्सो यू मेंशन्ड कि आई थिंक मुझे भी याद है 2013 में हम लोग ने बैंकिंग एंड फाइनेंशियल सर्विसेज NFO लॉन्च किया था एंड इट बिकेम अ बिग सक्सेस फॉर इन्वेस्टर्स इन टर्म्स ऑफ एक्सपीरियंस नॉट ओनली इन टर्म्स ऑफ AUM second again last year hum log ne pharma fund launch kiya tha and almost we're very close to the bottom of the pharma sector performance over the last 4-5 years in the context of 4-5 years so what do you think will be the next winner or winning business or winning theme for example for that matter
yeah.
and what would be your suggestion for asset allocation
yeah so I think broadly clearly in the core funds I would say that because we are currently agnostic to market capitalization right हमें लगता है कि लार्ज कैप मिड कैप स्मॉल कैप में सब में अपॉर्चुनिटीज है एंड इट्स अ क्वेश्चन हाउ यू चूज द स्टॉक सिलेक्शन इज गोइंग टू बी की सो इन दैट कॉन्टेक्स्ट अ मल्टी कैप फंड शुड गेट अ लार्जर एलोकेशन सो मल्टी कैप फंड में आपका ज्यादा एलोकेशन होना चाहिए तो वहां पे BSL इक्विटी इज अ फंड ओके फ्रॉम आवर साइड ना इन द मल्टी कैप कैटेगरी व्हिच आई वुड सजेस्ट अगेन अ फेयरली स्टेडी परफॉर्मर देयर अगेन नॉट टेक्स वेरी लार्ज रिस्क slightly value by some contra calls which the fund manager takes. Mid-cap exposure also is in a very range, right? From 20% to 35% in that thing, which is good in this kind of an environment. So I think that could be the fund of choice. Agar aapko thoda aggressive khelna hai, right? Multi-cap category mein, with a larger mid-cap exposure, and which can also work well now in this cycle over the next 3 years, we think that mid-caps and small-cap can also do well. Then you can look at an equity advantage fund. Again, थोड़ा aggressive होगा larger mid cap exposure, but slightly more growth oriented stocks there. So that's the two fund, but larger allocation almost like 35-40% multi cap fund is what one can look at. Then large cap will continue to be there as a second allocation because these are large blue chip companies and established names, okay, which would continue to find favor into the portfolio and in allocation. So there I would recommend say around 25% allocation is what one can look at, 25-30%. And there again, for investors who are looking at more steady performance and looking at the fact that the market breadth into any front-end equity fund, which has been a flagship fund, I think can continue to be there. But investors who are looking to slightly more differentiated strategy, right? Okay, more quality focus, and want them to pay that style, focused equity fund can be looked at. I think that focused equity fund, the way we are managing it, and if you look at our track record over there, even in the last 2 years since we have started to managing this style, has gives a good confidence that we should continue to generate a decent alpha over there. So I would say around, say 25-30% to the large cap. So that takes to almost like 75% allocation. Balance, I think around 10-15% can be done into a mid cap or a small cap fund, I would say. No? Small cap looks fairly interesting at this point in time, I would say. Right? Because small cap index, I was just looking at it, is down, still down around 9% in the last 3 years. Right, whereas Nifty, okay, is up by almost 3.7%. So one can look at the small cap with a 3-year perspective from here, either small cap or a mid cap fund. So that's where the allocation could be. And apart from that, thematics, if you really want, somebody wants to play a theme, then I think Gen X remains a very good, stable, long term theme. Consumption is a theme which we like across market cycle. I mean, aisa nahi ki abhi push karna chahiye. It's been a steady theme and we'll continue to do that. And in India, that's a long-term theme driven by demographics, driven by rising per capita income, urbanization, and all these trends. Okay, one can play it beautifully through our Gen X fund. But tactically, I would say that if you want to put in money, just like last year, we did discuss the pharma fund. I would say the banking and financial services sector fund, which we have, which is across, I think that can be a good time to look at this point in time. Still, it might look a bit contrarian, I would say, because the banking and financial service sector is still going through a lot of pain. It's coming out of the moratorium period currently. And the next 1 month will be crucial to see how much of that moratorium actually goes into restructuring on NPAs. But I think talking to the banks and interacting, we think that at least the good banks there should not see such a large problem, right, from the moratorium book, how it behaves going forward. And the cyclical recovery in the economy, And the fact that this sector now valuations is underperformed quite a bit in the last 6 months, the relative valuations look attractive. And over a market cycle, we see the banking and financial services sector has done well. So it's a good entry point now over the next 2 to 3 years to play this theme. And here also, I think while banking sector will still have some challenges, there is a lot of clear demarcation which is there here, right, between the good banks and the bad banks, and which will do well. You'll see a lot of consolidation here in the banking as well as in the financial services sector, and the good banks, good quality banks with good balance sheets, with good management will consolidate and gain market share. And they'll continue to grow faster than the broader credit growth in the industry. And overall other themes within the financial services sector like the insurance theme or the non-lenders, like which is a good long-term secular theme, both life insurance, general insurance space, even asset management, which one can play through this fund. So I think the valuations and the entry, I think it's a good time to someone to tactically, we have not given this call, but we are giving this call only recently to again look at the banking and financial services fund more from a tactical perspective.
Okay.
Just to add here, and besides your conventional equity fund, I think there's a lot of money which is there. I think there is a lot of money in the debt side or on the fixed deposit side, which is now going to earn very, very low returns, right, for the next few years is what our view is. So then that is a pool of money which needs to come into equity. But if it comes into some of these equity funds, there could be volatility and investors could probably find it difficult because many funds, people have sold some of the hybrid funds, the aggressive hybrid funds, against this investor, which is not a right thing. For those investors, I would say a good category to put in money could be the balanced advantage fund of ours, or also the asset allocation fund, because I think asset allocation fund is a theme which we have been now pushing it across pretty aggressively. We've been managing this product now for more than a year and experience has been good. So as you diversify across asset classes, not just debt and equity, but also into gold and other assets like the commodities, you diversify the risk and the different correlation of returns which are there across asset classes. It helps you to reduce the volatility and give you a more steady returns, okay, which are better than debt and a risk-adjusted basis, okay, that should do well. So I would say that these are the two categories, okay, which in this current market environment, I think should be a pretty attractive for investors who want to move money and looking at slightly better return than what fixed income can provide with lower amount of volatility. And I would recommend our Balanced Advantage Fund and our Asset Allocation Fund, I think can be looked at for those kind of investors who are looking at returns somewhere around 8 to 10% kind of return with low volatility.
Okay. So thanks, Mahesh. I think we overshot time, but I think it was worth it. Broadly, we have received lots of questions. I'm not going through each one of them, but broadly, there are two broad themes which kind of came up as we discussed through over the last one hour. One set of questions is around markets and, you know, I mean, the fundamentals versus markets, whether there's a divergence. Someone has asked that lots of businesses are not doing well. The fundamentals are not so strong and markets are running up. Is it inconsistent? Mahesh kind of gave the answer. And notwithstanding the short-term volatility, which is possible, but we are still constructive on equity markets. So there is one broad conclusion. And another one was on the fund performance side, that quite a few of our funds had performance delivery in 18-19 calendar years, which were not consistent with our long-term performance. So I hope the answers that Mahesh kind of gave in terms of inputs and the corrections that we have made and the outlook on the market and how are the funds likely to perform given our market outlook, etc. I hope you got answer to both these questions, whether to invest in market or not. We are constructive, notwithstanding short-term volatility. But unlike many, many other experts who do believe that there is a huge divergence, et cetera, between economy and markets, et cetera, for the reasons that we have given, we are constructive. And fund performance point of view, as you would have seen in last 3-6 months, it's quite visible, very clearly visible that most of our funds, in fact, all equity funds and most of our hybrid funds have made a very strong comeback in terms of performance. And we hope to continue from here on. Mahesh, any last few words from you, parting sort of advice or suggestions to our viewers today?
No, I would say that I think I'm seeing a lot of outflows currently from the mutual fund at this point in time. I think you need to really handle the investors and see, because there's still enough runway which is there, right? And the opportunities are there. I think in equities, once you get out, it's very difficult to get into the market again. Right? You wait for a correction. Obviously, there's a correction, probably you can put in more, but I think the regular investments which one is doing, I think one should continue. This is the wrong time to actually take out money from the market. I mean, I've been investing my own money into the market, even at these levels, right? That's one clear message. And secondly, I think in terms of as a fund house, I would like to assure you that as a fund house, we are committed to investors. Every fund house goes through a cycle. We went through a cycle, but we are also not rigid. Okay, we look into what has gone wrong. We introspect, and we've taken corrective action. And you've seen that across the actions what we have taken, and we'll continue to do that. And the team remains committed to ensure to our investors, ensure that the performance, okay, whatever underperformance we had in the last 1 or 2 years, okay, we'll make up for that. And it's important for investors to not move from one fund to, as long as you're seen the fund manager across market cycle, you know the fund house across market cycles, because typically what investors do is that they look at the fund return for the last 3 years and then invest in that, right? But it is important to look at that and the long-term returns also, but also look at what the funds and the funds manager organization is doing really, okay, to ensure that they come out from the cyclical, everything has a cyclicality, right? Out of that, and ensure that things are back on track. And I would like to assure this thing that we are pretty much on course again to come back. And we've already seen that. And we'll continue to do that the next few years. We have a very stable and strong team, which is there and which is committed. And even in this period, right, and this is crisis where we've seen pre-COVID and post-COVID, right, that is a good time when you've seen market downturn and upturn, right, in a very short time frame. How anybody, one has done in that time frame is a good testimony of how are we placed. If you look at it, the last 9 months is a good example to look at which funds have done well over that 9 months time frame. And I think you would see that most of our funds would have stood that test. And that gives me confidence that we should continue with this journey going forward.
Okay. Thank you, Mahesh. And thanks, everyone, for joining in. Next week, we'll have our senior fund manager, Anil Shah, join us. And we'll discuss ABSL Equity and ABSL Midcap Fund. So join our next series the next week at 4 o'clock. And till that time, thank you very much for joining, and have a good week ahead. Thank you. Bye-bye. Thank you, Mahesh.
Thank you.